what exists in the world for venture capital and tech is not built for Latinas. Like, it just isn't. And so you have to build it differently. It has to be new and innovative, or it's not gonna work.
Hello, Dallas. Hello, Austin. I cannot thank you enough for, we have so many people who are here tonight, not only from Houston, but also who drove all the way from Austin. If you drove all the way from Austin, please put your hands up. Let's recognize you. Thank you so much for being here. And I know there's people here from Dallas as well, who came all the way from Dallas. That is amazing that we're having all this support here in Texas in our ecosystem. So my name is Staci LaToison. I'm the founder and CEO of Dream Big Ventures. And I am happy to say I found my calling and my why, and I am following my North Star, which is to invest in women and diverse-led startups. My investment thesis is health tech, it's energy transition, because I have 22 years of working in the energy field, and also in climate tech. So I am pleased tonight to introduce you to two amazing, incredible experts who are pioneers in venture capital, and also really incredible people and family members. You know, we spent the weekend and this whole week hanging out with our beautiful babies and just had a really amazing time connecting. And we're going to be doing some really big things together. So without further ado, Senofer Mendoza and Adrian Mendoza of Mendoza Ventures. Welcome to H-Town.
That was pretty quiet for Texas.
Come on, H-Town, represent!
H-Town!
Hey, I want to say thank you for the ION. Thank you for Staci. The genesis of this is there's a man here by the name of Jesse Martinez that you may know.
He's trying to hide in the back.
He's over there. And Jesse and I have been friends for years, and he's Houstonite, Houstonian. They're better say it. But he and I met in Silicon Valley years ago. And a couple of years ago, he called me and said, hey, I have this thing. I want to bring New York. I want to bring San Francisco to Houston. I want to bring it back to my town. And I said, all right, Jesse, I love you. Great. And then he calls me back and says, I'm hosting the Tejano Tech Summit, the first ever. And it was last year. And he served tacos. From Villarca.
We're doing it again this year in October, so mark your calendars.
And Staci was the MC. And I loved getting to know Staci. That guy I know already. And 2 weeks later, I get a text from Staci. Oh man, thank you for coming. I want to be an LP in your fund. And I was like,
wait, Adrian.
Wow.
What's an LP in a fund?
Oh, an LP is a limited partner. It's an investor in a venture fund. And Staci, next to you know, she says, I'm an investor in 4 funds, 3 of them based in Houston. And all I can think of it was, orale, let's go, girl. And Staci was like, I'm putting my money where my mouth is, and I'm going to do this. I want to grow technology in Houston, and I'm going to write the check. And then Staci comes to me and says, I want to bring you to Houston. You need to come. And Sen and I were like, all right, we're here. Let's do this.
Yes. So the reason why I wanted, and thank you, Adrian, the reason why I wanted to bring them is because they raised a $100 million fund. They're based out of Boston, and they are the first Latino-led and female-led venture capital firm on the East Coast. Woo-hoo. So their investment thesis is fintech, AI, and cybersecurity. So I'm going to hand it over to Senofer now to let us know, what was it about, let's see, how did you choose fintech, AI, and cybersecurity?
We chose fintech, AI, and cybersecurity because you should always invest in what you know, and we are geeks from Boston, so that's what we could vet for pizza with our friends. We have a deep background in fintech. Adrian's modest about it, but he's the first person to get a mobile app approved by FINRA. A lot of his career was getting the big financial institutions onto phones. My background was in really large-scale design and enterprise sales, and so we had two startups together, and when we exited, we took a step back and looked around and realized that no one that looked like us was writing checks, and that the only way that that was going to change was that if we started writing the checks. So our first checks were small, and you know, we learned as we went, and our first fund was a combination of three companies. Our second fund was $10 million that we oversubscribed to $14 million. And our third fund is a $100 million fund anchored by Bank of America. So I always say
make some noise, Houston, because that's amazing!
You know what I love about this story is so much of the story of investors is what you're seeing on Shark Tank. It's, oh my God, this sports celebrity has, you know, a venture fund, and this actor has a venture fund. That's not the story with us. We were founders. We had tech companies. We had a sales team in the Bay Area. We had a sales team in the Pacific Northwest. We were running, you know, developers out of everywhere from Costa Rica, Latinos, and out of Boston. And our story is that if we can do this, anyone can. Staci's story is if she can do this, anyone can. And we're here to demystify what it means to be in venture capital, and also what it means to invest. If we, you know, the reason Sen and I started this is we saw no one that, we raised venture capital. There was no one that looked like us. There was no black and brown women writing checks. And we said, if it has to change and we want it to go to us and to our communities, we have to write the checks. And that's how we built Mendoza Ventures, little by little, literally 7 years ago. We had our 7 year anniversary in January. And what I love is that the first company we ever sold out of fund one, two Latinos from South Texas. We were at their wedding. Exactly. I mean, come on, give a Texas clap. Not only last year, we were at one of the CEO's wedding in San Antonio. He took over the McNay Art Museum and served tacos there. He had his VC speak at his wedding.
It's all about the tacos.
Yeah. And we realized, Sen and I looked back and we're like, through this experience, we changed the generation of this entire family. That's the power of what venture capital can do. We exited that company in 5 months, returned to 10X back to us. It not only made life-changing dollars for the founders, it also showed us the power of investing in venture. 98% of wealth in America is created through mergers and acquisitions. That's private equity and venture.
Yes. So, Senofer, you know. we have our work cut out for us because there's only 1% of female GPs in venture capital.
So 1% of all general partners at all in venture capital are female. So yes, there's a lot of work to do, but there were 0% of pilots when Amelia Earhart started flying a plane. So we can do this. I would say as founders, don't ever forget how much power you have in the venture capital ecosystem. If you are a female founder or a founder of color, that VC is your partner. If they do not have female representation in their general partnership, you do not have to take a check from them. And it may also be pretty representative of the voice that you will have in that venture capital firm if you are not represented in their leadership.
And at the same time, if you want to make impact with where your dollars are going, you know, Senofer, when you ask her, says, hey, what's the little thing I can take away right now? You know, go to whoever's, you know, your financial planner, your accountant, and ask, how much of my money is going to people of color, to women? Flat out. We do that with our service providers. We do that with lawyers, CPAs. We hold them accountable. And if you want to go further, say, all right, I've got a little piece of my risk bucket. Why don't I take a little piece of my own risk bucket? Because not everyone is going to be a startup founder. Not everyone's going to be an entrepreneur. But you have the power to take your dollars and say, even as a founder, start writing your angel investment check. Start taking a little bit of your retirement and saying, I want to invest in funds like Staci. I want to invest in funds like Mendoza Ventures. I want to make an impact with my dollars. And it starts with you guys.
I get a lot of questions of like, how can I write the check? You know, how can I start? If you can save up $5,000 or $10,000, you're an angel investor. If you can't yet save up If you can't yet save up $5,000 or $10,000, but you have a full-time job that gives you a 401k, you're already an investor. Have you asked your HR department if the 401ks that they're choosing are managed by women and people of color? If you have an insurance policy, on the back end of that insurance policy, they invest that capital to make sure that when you get into your fender bender, that money is there for you. Have you asked your insurer what percentage of their funds are managed by people like you? If you are handing a dollar to a bank or an asset manager or anybody else, you are already an investor, and every single dollar is a vote. So you are a customer who has the power of the customer to go back and ask them what's happening with that dollar on the back end. And I promise you, they will not know. When you first ask them, they will say, I don't know. And what I like to say is, if I were selling you a cake and I didn't know what was in it, would you buy it? So you can go back and say, well, go find out. Ask your boss, ask your manager, ask your head of investment. Cyberstalk them on LinkedIn and ask them yourself. And you have the power with that dollar vote to start turning this tide.
Yes, and I have the perfect example of that. My entire team is all Latinas. My social media and marketing, my logistics and planning, my video, my production, my executive producer over here. And that's deliberate, because that's what you have to do. You have to be intentional and have and be purposeful in your mission to, you know, increase the representation from diverse-led businesses. So I'm supporting my Latina business owners. Thank you. Oh, and my CPA, and my attorney, and my wealth advisor.
And your
VC. And my, exactly.
You know what? I like to say it's as easy as this. That's it. You want to learn how to invest in women or Latinos, people of color? It's right here. It's a pen. Just write the check. It's this easy. Look, I got it right here. Anyone wants to come over? I got the pen. You want to sign up? Come and see me. Everyone thinks there's this big chasm, but when you get a lot of us, you know, our story with Sen and I is we were accredited investors and we didn't know it. And then we realized, hey, we're accredited investors. Wow,
Adrian,
we should do something.
Accredited,
accredited investor is someone that has, you know, including real estate, including stock, including shares, has $1 million of net worth. And you know what? We actually had a Latino. He came up to me and said, man, Adrian, I manage other people's money. I'm a financial planner. And I said, guess what, Jorge? He's a Latino. You are now an accredited investor because you're considered a sophisticated investor. The SEC changed the rules. And he was like, wait, what? You mean I can become an investor? We started a Venture Fellows program a couple of years ago to teach MBA students. One of our Venture Fellows is right here, one of our alumni. She's over there. Say hi to her. That's Erica. She's in Austin, Texas. And a couple of semesters ago, we had an all-Latino you know, one from Houston, one from Austin. And I get this call from one of our guys from Austin, you know, Little Juan. He was actually here at Tejano Tech Week. And he said, Adrian, I now work at a private equity fund. And I said, guess what, Juan, you're an accredited investor. He said, Adrian, can I come into the fund? I'm like, of course you can. And he did. 24, is now an investor in a venture fund. That is going to change the trajectory of the access to the room. This is not about the investment, it's about the access.
Yeah, I can, you know, also give a testimonial. I mean, I worked for Chevron for 22 years. So, you know, we know about our 401k. We're told, make sure that you put so much, you know, into your 401k. We all know about real estate. We all invest in, you know, buy our homes, maybe have some rental properties. But I didn't know anything about venture capital until starting on this mission, you know, until I actually, Serena Williams, seeing her talk about Serena Ventures and only 2% of VC funds going to women and diverse-led startups. And I'm like, okay, well, I've already tackled the energy field, which doesn't have enough women. It's very male-dominated. So you know what? I'm going to make a difference and start in this venture capital so that it's no longer 1% or 2%, so that, you know, Sophia and Ellie here have the same access and the same opportunities as the men. Thank you. So let's tell them about your venture capital journey and, you know, how did you, you know, how it kind of got started, what kind of key takeaways and advice could you give to our audience here? Actually, can I poll the audience and see how many founders are in the audience? All right, we have a good majority. And how many funders, investors? Oh, I see some bank reps here that should be putting their hands up. Thank you for being here. So can you give them a little bit of advice?
Yeah, so Sen and I started our first company in 2009, 2010. And really we started it very much like it is now. We were working for another company. The market was losing 800 points a day. And the absence of any opportunity, we made our own. And we said, hey, we're going to start this company. And we didn't know what, you know, what it was to be a startup. We didn't know about access to capital. And we hustled for the first couple of years. You know, the VCs finally sat down with us and said, hey, Adrian, how'd you get this database built? And I'm like, I installed molding in somebody's house for my database guy.
He installed 3 floors of molding.
I did.
In the database.
And I got like $50,000 worth of work. It was great.
And I also, at that point, you know, in Boston, you had to raise a friends and family round. And we did not, we have friends and family that love us, but not financially.
Which most of us can relate. Most of us don't have that kind of friends and family connection. You know, a lot of us are first gen, we're immigrants, and, you know, as hard as our families, they work themselves to the bone, but we don't have that kind of resource.
So what we did was we worked two jobs and we lived off of half of our paycheck and we squirreled it away and we told everyone that that was our friends and family round. Just I were the friends and Adrian was the family.
We were the company's first investor. They started in our living rooms. And really, we did it because we said, hey, if anyone's going to do it, it's got to be us. And so we're a little bit more risk averse than most people you'll meet.
No, we're risk friendly.
We're risk friendly. Yeah. Well, risk friendly, whatever. We love risk. And so what we did is, you know, we then went out and raised venture capital. We didn't know what it was. We ended up raising one of the biggest rounds in the East Coast. We raised about 1.25 million when the typical seed round was 600K. It was so big, the VC had to call it a Series S. He's like, oh, no one's ever done anything like this. But we spent the time looking for the good partners. So 5 years later, the board looks at Sen and I and says, hey, we're gonna sell this company, go find something to do. And you're like, you don't have to tell us twice. We had great customers like Lululemon was a customer, Columbia Sportswear was a customer. And so then we had this sort of end to our journey. And some of the other investors were starting to talk to us and said, hey, we want you to run these companies for us. But during our journey, we saw no one that looked like us. We saw no one that was writing checks to people that looked like us. And we said, all right, and again, in the absence of any opportunity, we're going to make our own.
Well, and I think the number one thing that we wanted to solve for was that for us, venture capital essentially came from a black box. You know, you were given your check and you were wished well, and then you were held accountable at quarterly board meetings to try and make it look like you had a profit while you were still figuring out what your product was. And that experience does not grow healthy companies. We did well and we grew a company in spite of that, but we could have saved ourselves a lot of skin knees, like so many founders, if there had just been some transparency into that capital stack. There was a lot of smart money on the other side of the check that we got. We just didn't know who they were, to the point that 2 years ago, someone came up to Adrian and I and said, I love you guys, I've been following your career. I invested in your first startup. I was like, great, you engineered all this massive stuff. Where were you when we were figuring out how to run a 24-hour dev cycle? Like, that would have been helpful. And so the number one thing that we went out to solve was to let our founders know where their check was coming from and that a cell phone number came along with that check so that if they were having a good day or a bad day, they could celebrate or build a parachute while they were falling. And so that ecosystem that we built has scaled really well to the point that now we have corporations interested in the same relationships with founders. And so that's what we set out to solve. It should not be a disruptive business idea to have everyone in the same boat rowing in the same direction, but that's what we set out to do.
Well, and at the end of the day, to add a little more color is to add transparency and connect the founders and the funders together. Mm-hmm. That was the core built of what makes Mendoza Ventures magical. Because not only are we interested in creating net worth for the founders, we're also interested in how do we create this sort of, you know, multi-generational family wealth for the funders, the investors. And so a lot of what we do is not just about teaching founders and sharing the bumps in the road that we had. You know, it took us 7 years to understand how to build funds. It took us 7 years to understand, you know, the moving around accredited investors and the mechanics of building funds. And now what we really are interested in sharing that back. Mm-hmm. How do we share that back to bring in first-time investors, first-time LPs to participate, but also to build their own track record? Because the more of us that are out here in Houston, that are angel investing, that are investing in funds like Staci, the more we change the landscape of where the dollars are. I talk to here in Houston, is like, we want to build an ecosystem. It starts with writing checks to make sure that it goes as angel investment. It goes to fund investments, like to Dream Big, like to Mendoza Ventures, to get the dollars here and keep them here.
Yeah, thank you. So what are some of the keys that you look for when deciding whether to invest in a company or not?
I think there's three pillars in general. I think every VC in the room will agree with me that the product, market, and team all have to be firing on all cylinders in order to get an investment. Startups are an endurance run. They're not a sprint. So we have a longer diligence process at Mendoza Ventures because a lot like dating, anyone can look good for 2 weeks, but not everyone can look good for 2 months. And so we make sure that we spend a lot of time with those founders to see them deliver on expectations and goal set over time. That is very different than a typical VC.
Yeah, for us, we only invest in 12 companies out of every fund. We know exactly who the CEO is. We know who their families are. We know how much dollars are in the bank. We help them hire. We help them fire if they need to. We help them, you know, find customers, build partnerships, because your traditional investors have 80 to 100 portfolio companies. You know, I remember talking to an investor and I said, hey, you led that round. How much money did you put in? And he looks at me and goes, I don't know. I'm like, how do you know how much check you wrote to these guys? And so for us, it's taking that private equity mindset, small amount of portfolio companies, but also what we do is we involve the investors. We do events where we bring founders and funders together. We see where the capital comes, you know, and where it's going to go. And then the magic is these relationships. You know, we've had investors in our fund become advisors in the portfolio companies. They become board members. Some of them have actually even left their day job and joined them. And that is incredible.
Yeah, I think the line for us in this advisory role is that if an advisor is stepping into an operating role in a company, something has happened that's probably not positive. But a great example is we have a senior engineering advisor who's at Venmo, who's now helping me integrate a company into a larger acquisition. So someone that you can call as a friend and pull them in when you need them, but who's not in that operating role. If a VC is operating a startup, it's a bad day all around.
Yeah. Percentage or color is we leverage our investors. Mm-hmm. We have incredible men and women who are, have 20, 30 years in experience, from 20, 30 years of energy experience to those that are at banks. And we go to them and we know they're not going to leave their day jobs and said, hey, I know you really want to help founders. You know, in the example of the advisor that Sen was talking to, it was the head of product at Venmo. He's an investor in our fund and he said, hey, I want to help. Well, great. I have this technology platform and that founder would really appreciate if you gave them your perspective. And they're happy to share. And that's the perspective of grabbing these amazing men and women that want to share the domain expertise and putting them with these young founders who this is their first time, this is their first rodeo, and they want to learn. That's the power of what VC can do. Is it's not just the money, it's the advice that comes with it.
Okay, so now on our next topic, it's how can we empower the next generation of diverse founders and funders, like our daughters here?
Write the check. Just write the check and then make sure the kids see you write the check. So my daughter is 9 years old. And so to put it in perspective, I'm not the kid that was like, I want to work in finance when I grow up. I was designing 4 and 5 star hotels internationally. And this guy had a startup in my living room that needed to leave my living room. And I very quickly learned how to COO a startup. and so I have learned this entire industry. One of the great joys for me, I think we all have these career moments, especially if you're underrepresented in any way that you're like, okay, I did it. I moved the needle today. Was after COVID, we were driving through Times Square with our kids. And Ellie, her name, was looking out the window and she saw the NASDAQ billboard. And Adrian said, honey, that's the billboard that your mom was on. And so a 9-year-old Latina's first impression of Times Square is that's the billboard your mom is on. I was like, all right, I quit. We're done. We can stop.
Well, you also have to remember the power that you have in the ecosystem. We are all about paying it forward and paying it back. So if you're a founder in this room and you've raised a seed round, let's say, I don't know, at a $5 million cap, your shares are now worth something. You're now an accredited investor. Pay it back. Go to the next founder, and even if it's a 5-10K check, even if it's something small, start becoming an investor as well. Because I can't tell you that's the one thing that we should have done sooner, that really when we realized the power of writing the check as a founder to help the next generation that's behind us. I have this saying, and I usually say it in Spanish, but I'll say it in English, is that we as Latinos, we have a mission. We need to have one hand pulling ourselves up, the next hand pulling the next person behind us.
Right. That's right. Yes. So that kind of leads me to the next question. So what can you share with us? What does the future look like for Mendoza Ventures? You know, what would you like to accomplish in this next year, in 3 years, in 5 years? What's your vision?
The future has told us what the future of Mendoza Ventures is. My 9-year-old has let us know that we will both be let go and we will be rebranded as Kitty Capital. So if you ever hear of the launch of Kitty Capital, you know Adrian and I were forced into early retirement. Yeah.
In all seriousness, Staci, years ago, a university endowment, we were just raising our fund too. And this woman from a university endowment took me out for a coffee and she said, hey, Adrian, what's success? And it left me with a really, really good, sort of kept with me of what is success mean. And you know what success for us is we're going to make a bunch of investors, a bunch of money, and everyone's going to cheer, but that's not success. Success is building the next generation of investor and venture fund to spin out of from us. If you see that our logo, it's a circle with circles coming out of it, that's what we want to do, is that founders go and become funders. Funders go and sort of start next fund. You know, the power of having Staci as an LP is Staci's raising a fund next. We're going to help her.
Okay, next. Yeah,
she's next. Next investor series is Staci here by herself interviewing herself and saying, hey, I'm doing this. That's success for us, but also success is seeing the next generation of Latina, not just managing 100 million, managing 500 million, managing $1 billion. That is the next generation of investor. And our hope is what we do here gets you a lot of used to say, I could do this.
Success for us, and we travel a lot in every city, is the wealth of that city looking like the population of that city. That is success. When the wealth of Houston looks like Houston, when the wealth of America looks like the United States of America, I can sit down.
You know what? I like to say this. I am a son of Mexican immigrants. My parents came from Tijuana, Mexico, and in the 1970s moved to LA. My dad was a carpenter cabinet maker. My mom was a bookkeeper. The most advanced financial product they had was a CD that they would let go for 4 years to 2 years. If I can have $100 million under management, all of you in this room can do it. This is not, I'm not a sports celebrity. God, please no. I'm not an actor or anything. I didn't come from wealthy parents that had private equity funds. I came from the son of a carpenter cabinet maker who is an entrepreneur. If I can do this, any of us in this room can do it.
Wow. So can you also share with us, like, what are some of the hard-earned lessons that you've learned that you can share with us that we can try to avoid?
I think that one of the things I see a lot of is the expectation that venture capital will catch you. Venture capital is not designed to be a civic resource. It was designed as a playground for the wealthy to make more money. And we are putting diversity and inclusion on top of that. We're forcing that wedge into venture capital, but it is not designed for that. And so one of the great joys of my job is I get to see a bunch of different people try and solve for that all over the country. I sit on a national committee called the National Advisory Committee for Innovation and Entrepreneurship, because nothing in Washington is short. They're trying to figure out how to deploy capital as a government in a more equitable fashion. I get to watch everybody try and solve this, but the number one problem I see with founders is what I call the male Cinderella story of, I'm going to have a great idea and I'm going to build something with my roommate and I'm going to get funded and live happily ever after. And you need to detach yourself from that myth and remind yourself as CEO of your company that you are the CEO of your company, not the VC who's going to hand it to you.
Yeah, one of the things that we do, we've been in this business now in venture for 10 years. We've been in startups for close to 15 years. And we like to say that we help build ecosystems. We put founders together with funders. We look at areas, you know, like Houston, like Dallas, like Florida, where there's incredible talent that is overlooked. I like to say we don't invest in underrepresented founders, we look at overlooked founders. You know, that there is this incredible group of people that are outside of Silicon Valley. And for us, one of the important things that we see in ecosystem building is a lot of small ecosystems, Houston included, they look at us and say, someone should do something. The New York, the money should come over here and Silicon Valley money should come over here. And it's like, no, it should come from you. You want money to go to Latinos, Latinos should be writing checks. You want money to go to women, women should be writing checks. You want money to go to Houston, people in Houston should be writing checks. So much of the last 10 years in ecosystem, we see so many people saying, somebody should do something. And I'm like, the somebodies are here in this room. We have an ecosystem here and we have to support it. Because in order to build ecosystems, you need both founders and funders. You need incredible talent that is here in this room that is willing to risk everything to build something, to build wealth, to build jobs for families. But you also need the founders. You need the angel investors. You need the fund managers like Staci to be here as well. Because the reason that Silicon Valley is Silicon Valley isn't because a bunch of white guys were writing checks. It's because there's something called recycling of capital. Money goes into startups, they have exits. And the exits from startups, wouldn't you know, come back as LP investments into funds. It comes back as more angel investments. It can come back as philanthropy in the communities. They now have 3 to 4 generations of recycling that happens. We need that first generation here. We need your help to do it.
Yes, let's build together, Houston. So can you tell us about some of your promising portfolio companies and ones that have been the most successful? We'd love to hear about it.
This one's on my mind because I've been prepping for a board meeting this week. But we invested in a company called Listo, which is out of Northern California. And Listo means ready in Spanish. And so they are democratizing financial access, beginning with the Latino community. But the thing I love about it is it's a bunch of geeks out of Stanford. So like what they built on the back end can work for any population. And it's one of those startups that we can have a real impact with because of our relationships with the corporations that have invested in us. So a couple months ago, I got to sit down with the CEO of this startup and the CTO of Bank of America and the head of data for Bank of America and figure out what could they actually wiggle on. Anyone who's worked with a large corporation knows it can be tricky to get them to wiggle and sit with the startup and say, what can we change about what we provide to actually start meeting in the middle? And that to me is super exciting. You know, I love all the stuff that SpaceX is doing, but like I don't have the patience for 30 years from now. I like to see what's gonna change the life of the generation in the front row here, and I can see it in those moments. So that one was really exciting.
You know what I love about that story that Sen didn't cover? The founder grew up in Northern California. He grew up in Sacramento. He's Latino. He grew up picking fruit with his family. He got himself a scholarship to Stanford. He realized that there were people like him that also needed scholarships, so he started a scholarship fund. He went out, raised money to other kids that were picking fruit so that they can go to Stanford. He then went to business school at Stanford, and he came up with this first idea of, I want to start lending money to underrepresented communities. And they laughed at him. And he's like, all right. So they built a business school. In business school, you have these cases that are like stories. And now this case is taught at Stanford. And every year he brings his case to Stanford and he asks everyone, hey, everyone at Stanford, you smart MBAs, how many of you think that this business actually succeeded? And they all say, this business went under. Well, there's no money made from underrepresented communities. And you know what he does? He comes to them and says, guys, this business was called Opportune. It IPO'd 4 years ago.
Well, and my favorite story about Sam is that my favorite part about working with overlooked founders is that we're so used to figuring stuff out that we just figure it out. And it's not always graceful, but it works. And Sam went out into the Latino community to offer microloans. And anybody in the room who's Latino knows that they looked at him sideways and was like, what? Why would I loan money from you? But he realized that he needed that bridge to communicate to what they needed. So he went to Costco and bought a bunch of flat screen TVs on sale and then started selling the TVs out of a pop-up in the mall and used his own financial product to fund the TVs because that's what people were using the loan for. So he got his own customer traction, like literally unloading TVs out of a truck so that people would understand what they could do with this microloan. And I was like, that's my founder.
You know what? He, after he opportuned the company, he said, the company opportune IPO'd, he said, I'm gonna do it again. And now I'm gonna offer, and better. And now I'm gonna offer insurance products, lending products, credit building. And he started with building pop-up storefronts in neighborhoods that were being taken advantage of by loans and auto. And they became community centers. They would have posadas there. They would have like altars there. And 90% of these are run by women, by Latinas.
No, they're all run by Latinas.
All right, there you go. 100% are run by Latinas. Those are the founders that are building incredible things that we look at and say, the effect of what fintech can do can be life-changing. It can affect entire communities, entire families. And when we look at the founders, we look at like what impact can they do through the power of fintech.
Yes, and that's why I'm so proud to be an LP in the Mendoza Venture Fund. And that's why Chris is too, and he's always carrying around his VC puppy. So on that note, we actually have a special presentation. Can you tell us a little bit about the VC puppy before we have the presentation?
So our first exit, you can tell our kids who our kids are because they're ignoring us on iPads in the front row. Our first exit was two Latino founders out of South Texas with no advanced degrees. We 10X'd it in 5 months. This is where the lawyers make us say past performance is not indicative of future returns, but we're sure as hell gonna try. And so their company was called Good Dog Labs, and we got them the dog as swag for their company. And when they exited, we say the dog filled up and now he works in venture capital. And so every founder—
He has his own Instagram page.
Yeah, he's on—
huge following online.
He's on Instagram, his name's VC Puppy. And every founder and funder at Mendoza Ventures gets a VC Puppy. And while we love your offers, they only go to founders and funders. So you can have one, they're just a little bit expensive. And so he is our reminder to do that or better. We changed the trajectory of a family with our first acquisition. Adrian told you the story about his wedding. It's our reminder to do that or better. As we hand him to every founder and every funder, it is their responsibility to lift somebody up into every room that they walk into. Yes. And with that, I have El Jefe Mendoza here and Sophia, sorry, Ellie Mendoza and Sophia to present Staci with her very special Texas VC puppy.
Aww. Oh my God.
Can you say that? Can you tell them what you just told me? Go ahead. Can you say it? Tell them what you just said. Tell them. Come on, just say, Mommy, I'm so proud of you.
She said, Mommy, I'm so proud of you.
Aw, yay!
I'm so proud of her, guys. She's my hero. This is Sophia, and she's straight A student at Our Lady of the Guadalupe. She is brilliant. She plays chess. She plays golf. She just got selected to play in Annika Sorenstam's golf clinic on the 30th in the Woodlands because she submitted her amazing video about why she wants to see more girls and women in golf. So I'm so proud of you, baby. Oh, and the choir. She's a singer too, like her mommy. I love you. Mm. Thank you.
Good job,
Lee. Good job.
You can stay up here. So I know we want to make sure we have enough time for Q&A for everyone. So, but first I wanted to present a little thank you gift, as we like to do, from Dream Big Ventures. Not only for Adrian and Senofer, but we also have something for Ellie and Mateo to take back to Boston.
Thank you so much, guys. This is awesome. Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you, guys.
Also, we have a few sponsors that are here that are sponsoring our networking reception after the Q&A that I did want to recognize and offer them to come down and say a few words. If yeah, HTX, baby. So I wanted to thank SoftTech. SoftTech is providing our beverages this evening, so thank you so much to SoftTech. Wanted to also thank JP Morgan, so one of our new partners here. Thank you so much for your partnership and your sponsorship for our appetizers this evening, and Dream Big Ventures for everything else. And again, I want to thank my all Latina team for this amazing production. This is the second in a series of Dream Big Investor series that we're having here in partnership with the ION. Thank you for being a champion and an advocate for underrepresented, our diverse community here in Houston, because we are 44% Latino. And as you said, we need to make sure that our companies, our investments are representative of that. Our boards. So Christine, you can go ahead and start the Q&A session. Thank you.
I just want to give people permission to ask anything. Adrian and I are very transparent about what we do and how we got here. And I find that people are very polite during Q&As, but like you can ask us anything. If we don't want to answer it, we'll just tell you.
So if you have a question, raise your hand. There's one of me, so give me some time to come to you. I will try to get to you, but I'm not running on these stairs, so just bear with me and be patient. And please say your name.
Hello, I'm Adrian Blank's future angel investor.
All right.
Just curious to know what type of formation, like business formation, does a venture fund establish?
Yeah, I got it. So the reason why it's an LP is that when you become an investor in the fund, you become a limited partner in an LP entity. And that's managed by a general partnership entity, which is why you will hear the term GP versus LP, which is general partner, which is the fund manager, and LP, which is a member of the limited partner. And so you inherently own a piece of that entity. And so as returns come, you get returns back from, and as how much you've put in is how much you own in that entity, you get a pro rata back from, you know, your ownership on that entity.
Hi, my name is Dr. Ashley Atkins. I am the executive director of the Greater Northside Chamber, but I'm also a sociology professor. I study entrepreneurship and race. And so one of the things I heard you guys say was how VCs are not built with diversity and inclusion incorporated in them. Mm-hmm. But my question to you all is, what should founders do to make sure that they are reaching these communities where innovation is happening? Specifically on the north side, it's 70% Hispanic residents. Large proportion of them are business owners, and a larger portion of them are Spanish speaking only. And we don't see these type of events happening on the greater north side. And even though we expect the founders should come to the funders, that isn't said to happen in communities like that. So what should future founders do to make sure that they are going into these communities and reaching these founders with these amazing ideas that are often overlooked? Mm.
So we'll volunteer. We will come to the north side the next time that we're in Houston. So, y hablo poquito de español. So that's the first thing. What we find in lots of communities is that entrepreneurship as a career option is not really taught. And so that's a lot of the groundwork being laid in these communities right now, is that you can be an entrepreneur. I know our parents were still worried about us because we weren't, like, you know, working at a bank or something like that. So that learning curve is real. And then what you can do as a founder who is seeking funding is reverse vet all of your service providers, all of your venture capitalists that you're talking to. So a great example we have a lot of people that want to offer us services as VCs. And I say, what percentage of diverse VCs have you worked with before? And will you offer one as a reference? So if you're a founder who's a woman or a person of color, you can say, I want to speak to a Black founder that you've funded before, or a female founder that you've funded before as a reference. And start asking the question up, you know, every time you interact with the entrepreneurial community.
Yeah, and thank you for being here and for sharing it with the Chamber of Commerce there. And I am happy to come out and host an event there. Thank you.
Hi, how are you? My name is Fernando. I come from Mexico. I have a question. I've been helping some Latinos to come to the US. And sometimes part of the challenges that I see when you try to integrate them with the ecosystem here in the US is that the business is done different in their home countries. So when they come over here, how have you been able to overpass the challenge on connecting Americans with Latinos to have a successful investment project, and that they can collaborate and understand both sides of making business?
I got this one. More importantly, hola, que bien que viniste. Is find investors that connect with them. When you look at like the team at Good Dog, they always, when you ask them, they'll be an investor reference for us. And they'll say, Adrian not only spoke our language, he knew exactly where we came from. He was the only investor in our cap table to know exactly what we were dealing with, not just at the startup, but culturally. And so find allies that could help you, that connect you. Find people in this ecosystem that have worked with Latino founders, that have understood with their, you know, because here's the thing with Latinos, we are culturally liberal, we're fiscally conservative. And one of the things I hate about our communities, we don't ask for help. Everyone's like, yeah, you're right. We have to ask for help. And that takes those that are coming from Mexico, from LATAM, to start asking a sense at other founders that have done it before, that have broken through, and ask them for help. Who were investors that were a good fit? Who were advisors that were helpful? Who is in the ecosystem? You know, where's my buddy Jesse? Jesse,
he's hiding.
Chase that man down and somewhere say, here. Hey Jesse, can I borrow you? Can I ask you some questions and introduce you to some founders?
Español también. Yeah. Chris, aquí,
Ana Rosa. We just met last week in Dallas, and he's living in the wilderness, and appreciate you being here tonight. That was a really great question.
I would also say, like, a lot of your questions are even around, like, how do I get into venture capital? Like, make them come to you. So everyone in VC is greedy, and we love sales and good numbers. So, like, you need to make your numbers so good that they can't ignore you. And also, one of the other capital pathways I see a lot of diverse founders take, for example, Good Dog Labs is a great example of this. They had their customer fund the building of the product because the customer needed the product so badly, they were willing to invest in a startup to get it. And so, you know, Sequoia might be tricky, but whoever your customer is, if they need what you're building, usually those international corporations are also used to working internationally. And then the other option is a lot of the international startups that we've invested in go through what Adrian lovingly calls Senofer's finishing school for founders, where we talk about the etiquette of VC, we talk about follow-ups, what's expected, what to wear, what not to wear, who on the team should be pitching, all those sorts of things.
Yes, my name is Charles. I'm here to see that. Thank you all for the conference and bringing everything forward. But I got a dream of restructuring Fifth Ward with a company. And so therefore, you know, it's a new company, a new project, and new development. How is the easiest way for me to get rolling towards that goal?
I missed part of the first part of your question. Did you say restructuring the board?
Big pardon?
I missed a little bit of the first part of your question.
No. I'm trying to bring a business into everyone.
Okay.
In the community in Houston. Mm-hmm. And what I'm doing is, what I need is try to figure out how to structure and get going with a concept and development. Hmm. And so therefore, I come here today to see and listen to y'all. And I mean, I really need investment, but in the same sense, I need, you know, understanding that the product, you know, will be there.
Yeah, can Anderson, you are in the perfect spot. You are at Houston's ION, where every accelerator, incubator, you can come to Cup of Joey and just meet everybody here. Everyone's coming to the ION, and this is the place. If you come to the networking events, come to the networking events. The last time I was here for Tejano Tech Week, there was the Cup of Joey outside. I sat around with a couple of other people that were in your same spot, and I ended up meeting a couple of people from the different accelerators and started putting them together. I said, you should be in this one. You should talk to this person. So the first step is come to the, you know, some of the networking events here. Cup of Joey is the big one, just to start meeting with other founders and other funders and some of the ecosystem here to be able to find, whether it be advisors, mentors, people that are, you could just ask questions to, because this is the spot to do it.
I would also say really hammer out what that minimum viable product is. Like, what is the cheapest, dirtiest thing you can put in a customer's hand and show just a little bit of traction? Because if you can get that far, funding becomes much easier.
Okay, quick question. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
I like very much the fact that you're dealing with founders and funders. I had a conversation with a man who owns a VC firm that has raised $450 million. I said, how'd you do it? He says, we went to Bessemer, we went fund to funds, great big insurance companies. So is there going to be a limit when you reach $400, $500 million where you're not going to have the founders with the funders because you're dealing with high-level executives at the fund of funds?
There is no limit to overlooked talent. There is no limit. Hmm. Exceptional startups in this country are not getting funded right now. It is literally, we have more pipeline than we could fund if we had $1 billion behind us.
Yeah, I'll give you an example. I met black founder living in Oakland, $4.1 million in revenue. Do you know how much he's raised? $1 million and he struggled. He is across the bay from Silicon Valley in San Francisco. He is overlooked. You know what, that's not the only one. Orange County. Black founder, $3.1 million in annual recurring revenue. Same thing. No one's talking to him. And I'm like, I could have $2 billion. I would find a home for it. Hmm. Literally, in Houston, in Dallas, I would walk around. We have more pipeline. When people tell you, and the VCs tell you, oh man, it's a pipeline issue. I can't find women founders to fund. I can't find black and Latinos. I'm like, bullshit. They're all here. No. I literally call BS. They are right here. They're coming to us, and we have more. We have more founders and capital to deploy.
Yes. Where it becomes an issue is when you have to get through three layers of homogenous investment committee that don't look like the founder, and that is where unconscious bias really comes to play. And anyone who's different won't make it through that.
My question. Adds on to that. I'm Fernanda from Guadalajara, Mexico. How do you, as a Latina, from Latinas, a Latina is about entrepreneurship and venture capital, mainly a male dominated area. How do you try to grow and break through with innovative ideas, with new things that people are not very welcoming to? What do you recommend to someone?
You go first.
You have to believe in yourself. You have to dig deep and always believe in yourself, first off. You have to make sure that you surround yourself with people who believe in you and who are supportive and that you can bounce ideas off of. I mean, right now, I have the most confidence in the world that Dream Big Venture, when I launch that fund, is going to be a huge success.
I've got the Mendoza Ventures here that are like, okay, we got you. You know, we're gonna, so just know you can conquer the world and don't let anybody tell you that you can't.
And I'll add to that, because I think especially as women, you know, what exists in the world for venture capital and tech is not built for Latinas. Like, it just isn't. And so you have to build it differently. It has to be new and innovative or it's not gonna work. And so for us, you know, I had the worst case of imposter syndrome when we opened this firm. And I used to go into meetings and say, so my husband and I started this little venture capital firm because I was trying to make everybody else feel comfortable with the fact that I was there. The fact of the matter is, me making them feel comfortable was not gonna turn them into an ally. And if they're uncomfortable with me being there, they're not my LP, they're certainly not my friend, and they're not ever gonna work with me. So it's not worth trying to placate someone that's not in your corner. That's what I've learned after 10 years of beating my head against the wall. So I hope I just saved you a little bit of time. And then you have to find people around you to hold you accountable to that. Adrian held me accountable to that because he knows my potential and he's obnoxious. And then I held Staci accountable to that because I see her potential and I am also obnoxious and she was silly enough to give me her phone number. So you have to find those people around you to cross check it and have your allies, because it's real. When you're 2% of someone walking into a room, that feels like hell on a Tuesday. You need those people around you to get you through to Wednesday. The other thing that got me was like these two, like when there are children watching you, it is like, oh, it's awful. It's like having Richard Simmons watch what you eat all the time. It's like, it is accountability to the nth degree.
Well, and as a Latino, here's the thing. We're in a community where, like, we were lucky because my parents were entrepreneurs. There was no 401k. There was no savings account. But still, like, my mom would be like, oh, mijo, ¿por qué estás haciendo eso? Mijo, no hagas eso. We think that, you know, in the Latino community, there's a big boogeyman that's going to stop you. There's no one that's going to stop you. It's just yourself. And you got to push through the family that are saying, oh, well, that's different. Why are you doing that? And if you have to build a new community around you, you build it. If you need to find a move to a community, because I say the power of us Latinos is our parents or us dropped everything and we moved. Nowhere, no other community in the U.S., you know, very few communities have this thing where not only did we move, we could see where we came from and stand up high. We're like, oh, it's Mexico's over there. You know, Guadalajara's over there. Oh, shit, I can go back.
Adrian, I want to burst your bubble, but this used to be Mexico.
No, I know that. But, you know, look, it's we have a very different relationship because we not only left, we can see where we came from. And very few communities in the U.S. have that. My parents left everything. Literally came and went to the, if we can leave, if my parents can leave everything and come to a new country, shit, we can do anything.
So we're going to take just one more question. I know we want to get to our networking and time to celebrate. So our last question.
Hi, my name is Latias. I'm a founder and I'm actually a refugee to the U.S. So life, seeing life as a white guy who can somebody very well and doesn't have an accent, but growing up and seeing, and growing up in the marginalized communities, and seeing that kind of dichotomous life, I wonder, as you're going through these ventures and you're trying to create equity within, have you had governmental support? Do you see that there is a support system that's being developed to help kind of prop up marginalized founders, and what kind of ventures are available for that?
So I serve on what I think is the coolest government committee ever. And so we advise the government on how to be innovative and entrepreneurial, essentially like how to keep our edge globally. I sit on that with a bunch of other very successful VCs and founders, as well as the head of the NSF. And they've done a really good job of pulling together diverse people from different areas with diverse backgrounds. And so we just made one of our recommendations. And a lot of money is about to roll out into the US from the CHIPS Act. I don't know if you guys have been following this, but during COVID, we realized that nothing is made here. And so we're trying to make chips again in the US. And so $11 billion, which is not that much in the land of private equity, but it is a lot for government, will be rolling out. And our recommendation was to use that as innovation hubs, and there'll be press and stuff coming out around. I'm pretty sure I'm not supposed to talk about this yet. But this council is really holding the broader government accountable to looking at how we do deploy capital and making sure that we use hubs like the partnership that ION has with the local universities to deploy capital differently. Because to your point, if you make the metrics traditional, like you have to have built a manufacturing facility before and have an advanced degree and have taken in private equity, it's all going to go to the same things. So I will say we're getting there as a country. It is on the consciousness of the country right now. They're taking in advice about that, but big boats are slow to turn.
Well, I think the key here is, as everyone in this room, you know, yeah, there's the federal government, and we need to think locally. What can our local politicians do to build these ecosystems? We need to go to them, and there's a few of them here, and say, hey, what are you guys going to do about this? How are you going to support the ION? How are you going to support Latinos in tech? How are you going to support, and say from the, you know, start local and then go up state. Start state, then go up federal. But this needs to be, especially in the creation of ecosystems, it has to be us in this room saying something that we need this. And that's what changes everything, is we vote with our feet and we vote with our dollars. Nothing can stop us.
We both live in Massachusetts, and one of the successful things in Boston is the idea of a public-private partnership that they've rolled out. So a lot of the nonprofits that service Boston and service the ecosystem are a combination of city money, state money, federal money, and a corporation. And it's all those things coming together to do a thing that makes something that's actually sustainable.
All right, I think on that note, we will give our panelists a big round of applause. This was awesome, yeah. Staci, congratulations. Thank you again for a very successful panel. We're 2 out of 2, we have our third one coming. Senofer, Adrian, thank you so much for being here. I know we're just kicking this off and we have a lot of work left to do, but I'm super encouraged by the people in this audience, by the questions that were asked, and by the fact that we are showing up, we are asking the questions, and we're trying to do it not just differently, but better. And I fully believe that we have the right people here and here to be doing that. So on that note, let's go celebrate.
Yes.
Thank you.
We'll see you upstairs. We've got the DJ, we've got music, we've got drinks, and we'd love to come meet you upstairs. Thank you.